Okinawa Jima was the scene of the last great battle of the Pacific War. The capital and nucleus of the bead-like Ryukyu chain, Okinawa was only 495 miles from the coast of China, 380 miles from Formosa, and 415 miles from Kyushu. It screened the East China Sea, insulated the teeming coastal cities of China, and it was the lock on Japan's southern door. A vital link in the imperial mechanism, Okinawa was the funnel through which the enemy fed and reinforced his embattled fortresses to the south. Japanese aircraft, merchantmen, and fleet units paused at Okinawa's airfields and harbors en route to South China, Malaya, the Indies, and the Caroline. In American hands, Okinawa would represent the first conquest of Japanese home soil, for this island was an imperial prefecture. In American hands, Okinawa would mean the reduction of Japan from a powerful empire to an isolated land awaiting the shock of invasion.
On the 1st April of 1945, the 10th Army Division, commanded by Army Lieutenant General Simon Bolivar Buckner, started landing on Okinawa. There was four Army Divisions. There was the 7th, the 27th, the 77th, and the 96th. And there was two Marine Divisions, the 1st and the 6th Marine Division. The landing was basically very light. It was unusual because normally when the Marines or the Army had invaded an island, there was terrific casualties. It turns out that the commander of the Japanese forces had decided to defend the south because the terrain there was more suitable for defense. So instead of 75,000 people there, which we expected, there was over 110,000.
Okinawa, that was the biggest battle and the largest loss of life for Navy people. There's over 5,000 sailors that lost their lives, a lot of them to Japanese attacks. The Japanese pilots drove their planes into the ships. And on April 12th, one tried to crash on our deck, and fortunately, that plane was shot down before it reached us, 300 yards short of the goal.
In the south, the ridges were east-west, which was ideal for defense, as opposed to the north, which was hilly and brushy, and so the Japanese had very few people up there. So they had these series of ridges going all the way back. And now, of course, by the time we hit them, to go south was only 20 miles. But every inch was defended, not only by the Japanese soldiers, but the Japanese military of all branches. One thing that slowed us down on Okinawa was in May, when we were making pretty good progress toward the south of the capital of Okinawa called Naha. And that was the main objective, because we knew that's where the commanding general of the Japanese forces had his headquarters. But in May, it had 16 inches of rain. And I recall that at that time, my battalion was attacking in the north of Vietnam. And I remember a place called Onataka, and it was sort of straight up, and we couldn't hardly get up the hill because it was so raining so much. So that slowed down the people a lot. So the Marines took a lot of casualties. They had two divisions in there. The Army at that time had three were fighting. So we had suffered terrific casualties. Get through there. The company commander said, well, Luke, you take patrol out and see if there's any Japanese snipers that came here overnight. So I got three of my platoon members, and as I was getting ready to move out was a second lieutenant who was a forward artillery observer. He spent the night with us. He said, can I go along with you? I want to get some combat experience. And I said, well, you know, just fall into the rear. Well, we'd gone out maybe a couple hundred feet, and there was a very, very loud explosion. It knocked me down. Two men behind me were knocked down. But I heard these moans and crying and really terrible noises. And I was, of course, in shock because I'd been knocked down too. And I was trying to find what was going on. I looked down the hill, and there was this Ford Observer. And both of his legs had been blown off just below the knees. And he was lying with his head down the hill. And I didn't realize what was going on. I finally went down to him, and I seen what was happening. He had two legs blown off. I took my belt and made a tourniquet on one leg, and I took his belt and made a tourniquet on another leg. And I told the one man of the three who was still standing to go back to the company, get an aid person with a stretcher to come up and take this man back there. And so when the stretcher took the man back, and one of the men said to me, "Luke, your back is covered with blood." Now, I didn't realize that my whole back had been shattered with shrapnel.
Flame-throwing tanks pace the attack on Sugarloaf Hill, an eminence which forms the western anchor of the enemy's line and dominates most of Naha. Tanks blast Jap entrenches on Sugarloaf Hill. Battle for the hill rages a week as Marines make 11 attempts to reach and secure the summit. Capture of Sugarloaf removes the last obstacle to assault on Naha. Tank fire on the city is followed by air strikes, softening up enemy defenses before the Marines move in. Approaching the outskirts of the city, some of our tanks have extra treads wrapped around the sides for added protection against accurate enemy fire. Advanced elements of the 4th Regiment, 6th Marine Division enter the outskirts of Naha. Patrols mop up in the ruins of the city's outlying districts.
Well, if you'd been on Okinawa that night, you had never known how the sky could be lit up. You know, we just knew that the Japanese surrendered. We didn't know why they surrendered. We knew there was an atomic bomb dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. We didn't know that. We just knew the Japanese surrendered. The word got out. And believe me, all night long, everybody was shooting their weapons up into the sky. You know? So it was a great blessing. And, you know, because the war was over.